I think one of the things that really upset me about this so much is because I do a show about, you know, helping young people defend themselves intellectually from this kind of crap.
Right.
You're right. There probably is a lot of that going into this. But the finished product to me just appears to be, hey, have who is ever popular right now and a rap song and some dancing and some smiling.
Yeah.
You know, and just a bunch of vagaries, you know, about what's important.
I hope.
And that'll be enough to convince the kids. Welcome back to Podcast Masters, Liberty Masterclass, soon to be a cast.
Indeed.
I'm Brett. With me tonight, Gardner.
Guard. And Osborne.
And Osborne.
Yeah.
And it was a couple weeks ago that this came across my desk, this campaign, this new, it's not a new thing, but they have a new phase.
And well, we just have to say it's very strange the way things just come across your desk.
Yes.
It's like from out of hammer space. There it is. It's, boom. There it's on your desk. It's
frankly,
weird.
It's alarming.
Exactly.
Really. So this is all part of something called the Rock the Vote campaign. What do you know about it?
Okay, the Rock the Vote campaign. You reminded me. You jogged my memory, my friend.
Yes, yes.
You reminded me of how this this whole Rock the Vote thing started, and then my mind jumped a few years before that to that Frank Zappa campaign. It started in the early 90s, and it was Madonna and a whole bunch of other stupid pop figureheads, mm-hmm. you know, basically no talent, going out there talking about dumb issues and saying they wanted to get the youth to go out and vote. Rock the Vote, MTV. Rock the Vote. That was their big thing. And it, I can't believe it. These people are now octogenarians and they're still pushing this stuff with, you know, completely useless, talentless hacks again. It's just amazing. The only one who had any talent was the guy who preceded it, Frank Zappa. And he was doing this thing in 1988 where they wanted to get more people signed up to vote. And we can talk about that in a little bit as we sort of go back. But that's sort of the precursor. And then the 1990s, Madonna and all these other people at MTV started to put these little ads out on MTV. Like, get out and vote, young people.
Yeah, we're going to show our live video stream viewers one of these ads right now. The first one I ever saw, I was 14 years old, and it was the election of 1992. So it was George Bush, Ross Perot, and Bill Clinton.
Yeah.
Now, I, you know, as a naive boy, I said, that's nice that these people care about us voting and participating in the system. I didn't realize where Rock the Vote came from. Obviously, I didn't realize what the agenda was behind it. But that's stuff we're going to get into tonight. This is how it started. Let's take a look.
Okay, give me an A, you guys.
A.
Da 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 da. Vote.
Da 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 da.
Da 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 da.
Da da.
Truth is where you find it.
Get up and vote.
Da 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 da
da. Da da.
Truth is where you find it.
Get up and go.
Excuse me, but I'm singing in one key and you're singing in another. Dr. King, Malcolm X, freedom of speech is as good as sex. Abe, Lincoln, Jefferson, Tom, they didn't need the atomic bomb. We need beauty, we need art, we need government with art. Get in rhythm. Don't give up your freedom of speech. Power to the people is in our reach.
Don't just sit there, let's get to it. Speak your mind, there's nothing to it. Vote!
And if you don't vote, you're gonna get a spanky. Cut.
Oh my
God. So I would have thought, like, if I were going to create a campaign and call it Rock the Vote, there would be like actual rocking involved in
it. As opposed to Pop the Vote?
And not even that. I mean, what? I don't know what that was, but it wasn't rocking.
No, it wasn't. And this is the thing that gets me is, like, you were talking about how this was very risque. This was risque for the pop world. But,
sure.
You know, by this time, the Butthole Surfers were already going around on tour showing sex change operations, you know, projected on film. And Gigi Allen, you know, had defecated on stage and had sex with Lisa Suckdog. So, yes. You know, obviously different things for the pop world than sort of the underground world where the disenfranchised and disenchanted were sitting there going like, oh man, why do I just want to punch that woman in the face, you know? And it's amazing the way that they depict that stuff as radical. And you just sit there and you say, you're just whistling into the air. You know, you're just saying to yourself, that's radical. And it was for the pop world. You were absolutely right. It was 100% like, wow, Madonna, you know, and everybody knew at that time she had a very, very big gay following and mm-hmm. she was speaking out about gay rights and stuff like that. But it's like, you know, if you're going to a punk club or whatever, nobody cared about that stuff any, because it was all stuff that you'd already incorporated into your sort of basic mainstay anyway, you know?
It was already normal.
Yeah, it was already normal. I mean, you know, so it's a strange thing. It's sort of like now I listen to like classic rock stations and they're playing London Calling, mm-hmm. you know? And you're like, dude, you wouldn't play like WGIR in Manchester, Rock 101. They didn't even like talk about the Clash. You never heard the Clash. You would never hear that song on Rock 101.
Now, when it was coming, when it was new.
Yeah, it's 30 years later and they're finally putting it on the air. It's like, it's the same sort of thing with Madonna. It's like, well, where were you, man? What the heck? Hanging out at Studio 54 with the wide whale corduroys? What's up?
Exactly.
So yeah, it's frustrating. That's just my own sort of like social frustration at seeing that sort of stuff. It just drives me nuts. And it's so mindless and childish.
Yes. Gardner is taking a look at the chat. So if you have any comments you want to insert into the show in close to real time, as close to real time as possible, that's the way to do it. You can also call us, as we already mentioned. We are discussing the Rock the Vote campaign, which has returned. And we are also hoping to give you a little history and a little behind-the-scenes agenda of the Rock the Vote campaign.
Yeah.
I'm looking at a clip right now, also from about 15 years ago, during the 2000 election, George W. Bush versus Al Gore.
Very exciting one.
And this is this guy, this MTV guy. I don't remember his name, John something.
I don't know, but who's that woman with him?
That is Sheryl Crow.
Oh, wow.
And let's cut to that so you can see the still of it if you're watching our video. And one of the things, one of the comments that I had about this, and this is a thread that runs through just about everything we're going to see tonight, is the absolute like reluctance and lifelessness of everybody who's involved in this, right? So that Madonna ad, everyone appears to be drugged.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, absolutely.
And then there's this awkward exchange at some Rock the Vote event prior to the 2000 election.
Okay.
Here we go.
Highlights of the Rock the Vote party, their compliments of our street team, and I am here with a gum-chewing, until recently, Sheryl Crow, who is actually a presenter here at the party tonight, and of course the big honorees here tonight, Sting and Bono. I guess you're a fan of those guys?
And Hillary Rosen, who is a founding board member of Rock the Vote.
I was.
Hillary Rosen is like some lobbyist.
Of course.
Interesting. Democratic political strategist.
How strange.
Yes.
How peculiar.
Yes. So that's interesting that Sheryl Crow gives her a shout out.
It's good that she mentioned it. It's historically noted.
Increasingly bizarre
founder,
interview.
As she puts into it.
Yes.
I wasn't not counting Hillary.
Okay back off. Okay. No need to yell at me.
Now, you are a politically aware, involved performer. Do you think one day would you like to be honored for something like this?
I want to run for president.
Run for office?
No, but I just want to say really quickly that if you're going to vote, which you should be voting, that you have to educate yourself on who is voting for what. Because there are many candidates who are speaking with a forked tongue. So go out and vote for somebody that you know what they're running for, okay? And that's all I'm going to say about it. I don't care who it is, Gore, but...
And that's par for the course.
Of course. Mm. How strange that a campaign just to get people out to vote might have a subtext that comes out... to vote for Democrats.
But it doesn't even need to. That's what's so insulting about it. Look at that scary freeze frame. These nuts, these crazy people.
Wow, man. He looks like the guy who played Robin in Batman and Robin, whoever that guy was. He's possessed. His eyes are actually red in that picture in that
he
freeze
looks
frame.
Like he's about 6 frames from shapeshifting.
Wow. Sheryl Crow looks like she's been enjoying the bar.
Indeed.
Yeah.
So there's...
Wouldn't you have to survive an event like that?
Yeah, what I was saying, though, is they don't even have to push a Democratic agenda, and you will continuously see these pictures of, like, a handgun with a lock.
Oh, man.
In front of the trigger, like a padlock on the trigger.
Yeah.
A trigger lock,
yeah.
As it is known.
Yeah.
It's like a school locker.
Like, whoa, yeah, like a 36, 24, 36, turn and turn and turn and sort of thing.
Exactly.
And that's a really neat observation on your part too, Brett, because you're articulating something that was a vibe that I always felt every time I saw one of those things. I could never talk to anybody about those things because I was all alone, you know, and everybody else would be like, yeah, rock the vote. And they're like, oh my God, I think I'm going to die. You know, and it was always that sort of a subtext behind it. And they would have that imagery. And yet that seems to be the feel good thing. If you happen to say anything about it, it's like, well, how can you be against this?
Yeah, exactly.
We're all for this. It's like Invasion of the Body Snatchers. You haven't been snatched?
Exactly. All right, 25 more painful, awkward seconds of this.
Make sure that you vote for the person that stands for what you believe in, okay?
All right, the candidate has spoken, Cheryl Crow. Meantime, check out this band. You hear it first segment this week, a California band. They've been around 10 years, but maybe it's the first time you're hearing about them. They're called Fu Manchu. Check it out.
Fu Manchu. Well, at least they were playing Fu Manchu. I know that you looked into some of this background on the Rock the Vote thing.
Yeah.
And I just called up some of the info, and I just want to make sure that I toss some of this out because you were spot on. And this is Wikipedia, but they have the citations here. 1990, Rock the Vote was founded by Virgin Records executive Jeff Aeroff with the help of Steve Barr with a V, a campaign worker and political fundraiser, just like you said, Jody Udall and political strategist Hillary Rosen.
Yeah.
So that video that you got of Sheryl Crow was a great find because she mentions that in that interview on MTV. And so that's the origin of it. So it's very clearly a progressivist, collectivist move to try to get young people to vote on emotion.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now, they're... Founder Hillary Rosen, who you just mentioned, came from an organization called SKD Knickerbocker. It's a progressive public relations firm, and they do political consulting for the Democratic Party. Their current spokesperson, whose name is Audrey Gelman, also worked for that organization.
Isn't it strange too how you often hear young people say how they don't, you know, they never trust anybody over 30, that classic line from the 60s, or you know, it was in Planet of the Apes, and these people are not being open about their intentions here. You know, they're not saying, hey, leftist progressivists, get out and rock the vote. It's supposedly an all-inclusive, you're young, let your voice be heard, blah, 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 you know?
Exactly.
Except these are the issues that are important to the young, you know?
It's like the posters in the middle school.
Yeah,
like,
yes.
Have imagination.
Yes.
Be creative.
Yes, yes.
There are no stupid questions.
Yes.
It's just like, oh.
Only stupid posters.
Yeah. Don't take that seriously. As far as like what you can expect in the actual school environment.
But this is the sort of mentality that always used to bother me when I was a kid, because you would see this and you'd say, well, this is coming from someplace.
Yeah.
Obviously, this has an ideology behind it. So it's sort of like when we were talking in the last PodcastMaster thing about editors on television news or watching filmmakers. You know, there's a mind behind that. Mm-hmm. There's a mind behind the selection of the stories. What goes first, how much time they're devoting, and who they're interviewing, or the angle of the camera, low angle, high angle, the lighting, the focus, the focal length, whatever it might be, someone is behind that, and it is done for an effect. This shows me that these people don't want to be honest with people, because if they just came out honestly and said, hey, we're left-wingers, we want to rock the vote for left-wing causes, okay, I get it, but they're not saying that. They're not saying that at all.
I agree with what you're saying to an extent, but I think one of the things that really upset me about this so much is because I do a show about, you know, helping young people defend themselves intellectually from this kind of crap.
Right.
You're right. There probably is a lot of that going into this. But the finished product to me just appears to be, hey, have who is ever popular right now and a rap song and some dancing and some smiling.
Yeah.
You know, and just a bunch of vagaries, you know, about what's important.
I hope.
And that'll be enough. To convince the kids.
Well, you know, it's interesting. I don't know what sort of an effect this has, but I hope, you know, I have enough faith in people, you know, who were that age that I was when this started in the 1990s, that hopefully they're seeing this and they're like, this is frigging stupid, you know, but I don't know.
I hope so too. That's why I wanted to do this show.
That would be.
We're on to you. We're on to all of you. Turn out for what Turn out for Waters.
Bye, Johnny.